Hello, everybody, and welcome to the MLG North American Qualifier for the World Finals. We have Complexity Gaming facing up against Cloud9. Again, I apologize for the delay. Things have been a little bit crazy, but we're finally here with our first game between Complexity and Cloud9. I won't be solo casting. I'll be joined by Clairvoyance here in just a little bit. I'm just not sure where he's at.
5 seconds remaining.
Once he finds me, though, we're ready to go. Lina is going to be the first pick here for Complexity Gaming. What a surprise. The hero that pretty much everyone sees as a really valuable first pick. Could be a four position, could be the mid. Either way, super valuable hero. And what's really left in the pool then? There's certain heroes like Earthshaker. There's a lot of valuable supports. They did already ban away the Tusk, so perhaps Spiritbreaker or Earthshaker is a valuable pickup here. Or we can go for, perhaps one of the early mids. Queen of Pain has dropped in popularity, though. This is Radiant side, so SF is a possibility here, especially with the Dazzle. You have a good amount of synergy with the minus armor combination, but I'm not sure if SF is going to be valuable enough to go in the first one, too. Only because it was it's Radiant side would it really be possible. And Claire, is that you?
Hey, Cap, can you hear me?
Oh, boy. Yes, I can. I can hear you loud and clear.
Oh, yeah. This is the first time we're doing this TeamSpeak thing. You said Durka. I didn't realize it was actually you. I was just kind of getting confused because I'm watching the stream. Durka's still casting a different game, so.
Yeah, exactly. I know. I'm on Durka's Steam account. I'm on TeamSpeak says Durka for some reason. It's just Durka. But it's me. It's Cap.
Yeah? Sounds like a mess back there. You all right?
Yeah. It's just been a little hectic. It's just like the defense going on too long.
10 seconds
and apparently the admins, they told the teams at a time, like, hey, we're probably going to have an half-hour delay. And they were pretty cool with it, but then as the half-hour wore out, Complexity wanted to start. So I just kind of like, okay, go ahead, Durka, solo cast. I'm going to go jump into that other game and get the game started because I didn't want to delay it any further.
Right. So. Well. Sounds good. At least we're both here now.
Yeah.
Does that mean I have to turn on my Dota TV mic, or how does it work now?
No. You're still good. You still go through. Go through
great.
My audio.
Not doing any changes on my end here then.
Yeah. Oh, there's the Spirit Breaker. So.
Yeah, it's an early Spirit Breaker pick, but if you've seen some of their cool games recently, they started running this Lina Spirit Breaker dual lane offlane. I'm not sure if they're going to do it here, but it's an option they can fall back on. Mm. So Cole have a very strong Lina first pick because they have like four players that can play the hero right now.
Yeah. Okay. That sounds interesting. I kind of like that idea with a different way to be able to run the four position Lina that is able to get a little bit more experience than perhaps your normal defensive tri-lane.
Yeah. Also, you're actually super low on my end. Is there something I can do about that or?
No, I don't think so. I can't really turn myself up too much, because it sounds fine in XSplit, so. Probably just up your volume. I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, it might just be a TeamSpeak thing. I don't know.
Okay.
Regardless, I mean, I can hear you and make out what you're saying at the very least, so I think it's fine.
Okay. What's our second set of bans? Complexity using a lot of the reserve time. Okay, Windranger. One of the few heroes that matches up decently well against the Lina, right? Lina's really tough to beat in lane.
Yeah, she's just I think that Windranger's like a pretty inferior version of Lina. She's similar in some ways, but can't quite match up to the punch that Lina really packs. Then again, they are both squishy intel heroes. Lina is not very good against Clockwork for one thing, so mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see the ban.
And Spectre? Cloud9 been running some Spectre?
Yeah, they have. They, 10 seconds remaining. I think the carries that they fall back on most right now are Anti-Mage, Spectre, and Slark.
Remaining.
But I'm not sure how Complexity's got to deal with the potential Slark. I mean, they have a lot of burst so far and a lot of lane pressure.
Time.
Assuming that they can dual lane off lane with this. So we'll see what the next ban's coming out of Cloud9 here.
Yeah, I saw the Anti-Mage and I saw the Slark game. And I was just like, okay, that's pretty normal. Spectre, though. Did not expect any team to really be valuing that one too highly.
It's actually a pretty strong hero right now, I think. Haunt is a very...
Why is that?
Pardon me?
Why is it so valuable?
I mean, it's like the hero as a whole is kind of underrated. I think people have started to recognize that Haunt nets you some kills, and right now in this meta, kills are pretty darn big. Because her ability to catch up after laning phase is not very strong. She doesn't really farm that well, per se. But, yeah, it's like there's a lot of teamfight in the mid-game in this patch, and Spectre pretty convincingly wins that a lot of time with just the click of an ultimate button. Mm-hmm.
Now, what about... we still have a pretty big carry left in the pool, and I feel like he's probably one of the more powerful carries. The Phantom Lancer for both sides here. Both sides have their carry. Is it valuable enough to pick it up here in the 3-4 before the enemy can? Or do you feel like PL is not as valued highly in... I mean, we talked about this before. You feel like the Europeans are running the Phantom Lancer a little bit better than North America right now.
Yeah, the NA teams have definitely started losing faith. I mean, honestly, look at the... This game is a good example. Like, you would think PL is good against Cloud9's lineup. And by, like, on paper, PL's actually really good against heroes like Shadow Fiend. Clockwork does nothing to him, and Dazzle, to an extent, can't really apply pressure to PL in the main game. But these three heroes have the ability to close out a game early after, like, a clock initiation and a team fight. They can always get, like, one or two towers. And now another hero that comes into the question where PL is not really good against the Ember Spirit. Once he gets a Battle Fury or two, Sleight of Fist kills all the illusions and pretty much kills his team as well in the process. So... Yeah, it's in the NA scene, PL has definitely fallen from its grace.
Cloud9, what else can they combo here with? Because they've got this minus armor bit. I was talking about before you came in here, the second pick potential Radiant Side SF. And I said, you know, it would only be second pick essentially because it was Radiant Side, because it would be so valuable in that position. And it does have the synergy with the Dazzle. Cloud9 do get the opportunity to third pick it here. But how much minus armor do you really think you can go for? Because I feel like the Slardar combination with SF actually works really nicely against the Ember Spirit as well.
It is always nice to have more negative armor, but Slardar doesn't really fit the vision of the one position hero in this meta.
Yeah.
I think we also touched upon it the other day too, but remember how far I ran the offlane Slardar on Mu, and it's... Mm-hmm. It really does belong in the offlane right now, and I'm sure in the future, depending on the changes to the patches, Slardar might even be ran as a midman. But as a hard carry right now, you know, just you need some sort of ability to either take over a fight Spectre style, or you need to be able to split push AMPL style. And Slardar's not too exceptional on that front.
Yeah. All right, so the four position Earthshaker is the choice for Cloud9, leaving their carry for last. Ember Spirit is most likely going to be our mid here, right? But it's got to be a little scary going into an SF as well as now the Earthshaker. The roaming potential there is pretty high.
Honestly, yeah, I don't know. I don't know if the Ember's going to be mid.
Yeah,
it's like Ember versus SF is a very hard matchup for Ember. Ever since the Raze got the 25 damage buff, and the changes to the mid as a whole, yeah, there's the real mid hero there, Templar Assassin. Probably one of the best heroes in this patch right now. But yeah, Ember in general is just, it's not that good against SF anymore. You can't stop him from farming his stacks. His shield gets rubbed off by two raises that, like, at any point in the lane. And it's just overall difficult, I feel, for the Ember. Remaining.
All right, so that actually makes a lot more sense. Templar Assassin versus the SF as a mid matchup. Complexity. Now just
need Cole's lineup right now is Cole's lineup right now is really greedy. The thing is, Cloud9's lineup, if you look at it as a whole so far, they don't have that much damage, which is why Cole can kind of get away with this, not to mention the fact that TA is extremely resilient to instantaneous damage, and Cloud9 has a whole bunch of that coming out of ES and Shadow Fiend. But yeah, strategically, I'd say Cole is... I favor them right now, but their lineup is definitely really greedy, and they can get punished very hard in the early game if Cloud9 play their cards correctly.
Huskar going to be banned away by Complexity. We have the Bloodseeker. It's funny how those almost sort of like cheesy carries end up as the last bans for so many of these games that I watch, just because it's like the last pick Bloodseeker, last pick Huskar. You're just like, oh, God, what? Oh, our draft isn't meant to deal with that at all. So Cloud9 still needs to decide what their carry is going to be.
10 seconds
Complexity
remaining.
Still need a nice hard 5 position to babysit that Ember Spirit.
5 seconds remaining.
Yeah, just waiting on it for now.
I wouldn't be surprised a Rubick for Complexity, honestly. I feel like you've got a decent amount to be able to steal.
I thought they were going to pick it instead of the TA, honestly.
Yeah.
And there it is. That's the Slark.
All right.
I was just going to say, I think Cole was actually aware of this. I mean, if I could stand at the caster table and know that the Sark is coming, then I'm sure Cole, who have experience with Cloud9 more than I do, mm-hmm. will certainly see it. But I'm not too sure if they were afraid of it. Again, Slark is a hero that, in the laning phase, it's not very strong. It's kind of hard to kill. It's kind of elusive with the pounce. But honestly, Lina's Spirit Breaker, if they really do go for that option, this can do a lot of hurt for the Slark in the early game phase. And TA versus SF, this matchup kind of goes both ways. It's favorable for the SF nowadays, but I think TA can most certainly win, especially the solo kill potential after 6.
Yeah.
So all they really need is a guarantee for the Ember. And Rubick's not only really good against SF, but one of the most referred to tools to deal with the early cogs in the clockwork.
Does this change anything for the Rubick support pickup for Complexity, the Slark? I mean, he is one of those supports who can't really defend himself against the Slark, but I still see a lot of value, especially
actually,
in the lane.
Actually, you know what? Yeah, yeah. Now that you mention it, though, Rubick is probably one of the worst supports in the game against Slark.
Yeah.
Straight up. Like, when Slark goes on a Rubick actually can't do anything. It's just all these single-target spells. Even if you get them off, he can dark pack. Yeah, there it is, the Winter Wyvern. Again, much less presence in the early game, I think, because Winter Wyvern just has Arctic Burn, and 50 seconds later he can use it again, but it's not that much pressure for a Clockwork. I think Clockwork's going to actually have a really easy time in this lane, but I really wonder how they're going to do it, because the Slark getting free farm might be kind of scary for them. This Slark has a lot of good pick-off potential this game.
Hey, Claire, just real quickly, are you able to check? There seems to be a lot of static coming from your mic. A lot of background noise. You know, if...
Is it coming from my end, or...?
Yeah. Because it goes out every single time your mic activates.
Okay. Just give me a moment. Okay. I'll be right back.
Sure. Winter Wyvern is going to, obviously, round out the lineup for Complexity. Way too will be on that one. You see, got Ritsu Slark. Brax is going to be taking the main
10
SF.
10 seconds remaining.
So we'll see how the
5 seconds remaining.
Aggro dual lane that Clairvoyance was talking about earlier, the Spirit Breaker Alina, if that's still going to be run by Complexity against this matchup, because it seems pretty dangerous with the Slark being able to go forward, hit that pounce. You have the, I mean, if the Spirit Breaker is the one who's targeted, right? He's obviously going to be tanky enough and has enough armor. He'll be okay, but. Swindle already throwing some shots over to Ritsu, who's played so much Slark lately. It seems like every single time I watch a Claw 9 game, Slark or Anage. Slark, 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 Anage, Slark. They did recently have that Luna game, though. That was kind of interesting. Anyway, pause for both teams to figure out what is going on. All chat back and forth.
Hey, Durk. I was about to call you Durka. Sorry, Kat. Is it any better now?
It's still there, but I think it's a little bit quieter.
Okay. The static, correct?
Yeah. Okay, so I was just kind of talking to myself earlier. Does Complexity still run the aggro dual lane that you were talking about, Spirit Breaker and Lina, against this defensive tri-lane of Earthshaker, Slark, and Dazzle? Claire? Alright. Probably he's fixing his mic some more.
Okay, how's this?
Try again. Just start talking a little bit. Anyway. Alright, so we'll wait out the... Okay. Maybe... Alright, so we're probably going to switch servers here. This has a little bit too much static. Let's see. Dun, 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 dun. Man, Skype being down has been such a hassle.
Bless your soul.
All right, and away we go. We've got our game final. We're already seeing the early start out here with the offlaner and support bull TPing out to lane. Z-Freak trying to get that early ward down, but will not be able to do it. So, no early block of the camps. Looks like they are still going to run the aggro dual lane, MJW, with the Lina. Going to be paired up with Z-Freak's Spearbreaker.
Hi. Just going to try to talk. I'm not too sure if anything's different, but...
It's not the worst thing in the world. Honestly, I think it's fine.
Okay, yeah. I don't know how to fix this on my end. I honestly think it's just like the fact that we're trying to get picked for the first time.
Yeah.
It's just weird. I tried lowering my settings, but the...
That's okay. Hopefully, maybe we'll get it fixed for game two.
Okay.
Anyway, so the Lina Spearbreaker, aggro dual lane, coming out from Complexity. You mentioned this earlier. Do you think this is still a good idea, given the defensive tri-lane that they're up against? Do you think they're going to do fine?
I think it's just their the pressure. And begins. Yeah, Swindle's going to get blocked out of the rune here, so this is a free win for Brass. So he'll be happy with that. In terms of a good idea or not, again, we'll just have to see how the lane cleans out. I don't think this is the strongest tri-lane coming out of C9. It's mm-hmm. just a very standard one. Dazzle and ES.
Alright, so our mid matchup is probably going to be one of the more important ones to keep our eyes on. Templar Assassin actually going for the first level of Psyblades. And this is going to mean you take a lot of potential harassment. Is this standard now for Templar Assassins? I've heard of some builds that go for the Psyblades first in order to max out the harassment, right? Yeah.
Yep. Every TA, I mean, I know all TAs in North America will do it for sure now. I don't know about the European or the Chinese TAs, mm-hmm. but yeah. Even against SF, which used to be, against SF and Storm, you could do Refraction, or people thought, but no, just the Psyblade just happens to be better most of the time.
Okay.
I do want to say, without the Bounty Ruler, you really might want to be Refraction.
Yeah, I felt like it was a little bit more matchup necessary, and then add in the fact that he's not going to get that really fast level 2 off of the first couple of creeps due to the lack of Bounty Rune. He's going to be suffering a lot of early damage. He's going to have to start eating through those tangos pretty quick here. Brax really trying to approach that advantage. Does have the health potion over Swindle right now. The other health potion does finally come in for Swindle, and that will kind of even things out for him.
Yeah, well, he'll get the lane back here now, so some well-needed CS coming his way here.
Our bottom lane seems to have got the creep equilibrium to their favor. It's pushing into the tower, but... At the same time, they were unable to be able to get the early ward on the block, and 1437 stacked it up, and he's going to be able to pull. So this is going to be a lot of denied experience for this dual lane, which they do kind of need to get Z-Freak to level 2 as soon as possible so he has that kind of offensive power and maybe even the option to roam into that middle lane. But it's just shy by 5 experience right now.
Yep. A little unfortunate, but... In the meantime, Clockwork in the offlane is having a very good time. Level 3, zoning out this level 1 Winter Wyvern with a couple of right clicks. Already has Boots and Stout, so it's pretty unkillable with his simple dueling so far. But Ziz does have level 2 Flame Guard, so if they do get a good jump on him, they might catch him and bring him down.
SVG. Looking for the rotation across, see if they can catch MJW, but Z-Freak's keeping constant vision here on the side, making sure that SVG doesn't get the opportunity. The aggro dual lane does seem to work out pretty well. We have yet to see any real aggressive action out from Cloud9 just yet in that regard. Meanwhile, the middle lane seems to be going decently well for Brax, and it'll only go better over time as he's about to pick up that coveted level 5 and start double spamming out the wave. Is currently sitting 12-2 compared to the 11-3 on Swindle Melons.
Yeah. I gotta say, Cloud9 is just doing a really good job so far of managing all the pressure. Even Brax, I think he should have been semi-wary, or he might have felt semi-wary of the potential Spirit Breaker charge, but as you said, SP is giving vision for his Lina, but he's also taking away the potential threat that he has on Shadow Fiend, and they do have a mid lane ward placed, so they would see the charge coming. Even at the bottom lane, they have a lane ward too, so this SP doesn't have too many opportunities for the mid lane here. So far, they're getting their CS. Top two on the CS board is SF and Slark, so they're doing a pretty good job.
Couple denies coming out as well. I'm really surprised MSS is doing as well as he is. Did he start out with the Radiant Conk, where he put some of those creeps into the side? Is that how he got so much early CS in order to get the quick boost?
Honestly, I didn't pay too much attention to it. Was busy trying to configure my microphones and whatnot. But
right.
Again, like Clockwork, it's just it's not an easy hero to zone naturally. When you have a melee carry, it's all the more difficult. And then you have a Winter Wyvern, which is not known to be the best safe lane support.
Oh, MJW is going to be caught here. Ritsu does manage to get off the Dark Pack at the right time, but he drops low, and now the charge is going to come in, and there's nothing to stop that one. He'll be hit once and twice for the first blood. And now SVG, they manage to get a good bash in here, 17%. Z-Freak really gunning for it, doesn't quite get it. Now the heal comes out, and they do end up dying. And that was just the missing castle fact. Oh my goodness. 1 for 3, 7, bump back, and a 17% just before the Shallow Grave could come back out. Z-Freak knew he was stocking up those bashes, and now he's gonna go for 1 for 3, 7 as well. Bash, not quite yet. One more hit, 1 for 3, 7 though, has the Shallow Grave, and he's trying to bait out Z-Freak. Ritsu actually trying to go for that kill on the Spirit Breaker, but there's no way he would just be able to stay one step ahead of Ritsu as it is. So Z-Freak's actually gonna back into the jungle here. It looks like he's trying to get himself into a position for a good charge into the middle lane.
Yeah, he's also scouting stacks in the meantime, and TA does have traps available. So this Shadow Fiend seems like an easy kill until they realize the Earthshaker's camping. And then they'll know that they can't actually make the play. But they might go for it anyway.
They looks slow like down Brax with the trap. The charge's gonna come in now. They do hit Brax. Winamons comes forward, Melt Strike, and a Dragon Slave out from MJW does take out Brax. So heavy commitment there from Complexity, but well worth it as they get the kill on the SF and back out.
That was really unlucky for Cloud9. SVG was like scouting the whole area and just stacking that one time and missed a charge. Again, I guess it's credit to Z-Freak as well for coming from such a nice angle.
Mm-hmm.
It's always terrible to be charged or arrowed from that angle from the Radiant side where you can't see anything coming. You're not going to sit in the woods the whole time. And it's just a really easy point of initiation. So well done by Complexity for taking full advantage of that. But in the meantime, Clockwork, camping top blue, I figured he'd be 6 by now. I guess he was busy just hovering around and tried to help mid for an instant until he realized that he didn't get anything or he can't really get a follow-up catch.
Mm-hmm.
Money to
so
burn.
He'll be looking for that level 6 as soon as possible. Here's an invis room to help him on his travels as well.
Yeah, maybe he can use that to get a pick off on Swindled, though they do know about it thanks to this ward, so Swindled's probably just going to play real safe while the Clockwork is off map. He pops it now out of vision and starts rotating in. Swinemons not wanting to push forward at all, but may just get a little too greedy. Refraction is out for now. And MSS thinking about going for it. They do have the Earthshaker ready to go. Are they going to wait out the Refraction? It almost looks like they're trying to.
I don't think they need to wait. I think they just go.
I don't think so either. They could just make the jump, and they've got plenty of damage, I think. Swinemons does. Oh, wow. He's now going to be able to get his bottle, starts healing up, has another refraction ready to go. I can't believe they didn't make the jump there.
Yeah, I think they go for it for sure. You know what? I think they're going to go here now.
Yeah, they finally lock him down. Will start bursting through him, but he does have the melt. Turns around, starts getting some damage. Mass rotation, though, coming out from Complexity. A nice two-man Fisher, but that was three different TPs towards that middle lane.
Yeah, that's actually worth it. At the end of the day, even though they didn't get the kill, and I think if they did it like on the previous creep wave, they would have gotten it for sure. But yeah, that was still totally worth it because they forced three ports. And look at this, Ember's walking back to his lane, missing a creep wave. Nina's doing the same thing. And Winter Wyvern's now sitting behind the Templar, admit.
Slark does have his level 6, so opportunities for extra aggression now at that bottom lane. We'll see if he actually gets the opportunity though. Swindle's still trying to. Do they have stacks up in the Ancients? No, they don't. Not yet. That's what Way 2 is going to be doing now. But he need to start setting that up. It looks like Swinomelons, though, is going to be going for the early Roshan here with this build. He's got two levels of Melt rather than more levels in Psyblades, which is usually associated with stacking and clearing through Ancients.
Yeah, I'm surprised. I'm surprised he's settling with just one Psyblades. Level 2 Psyblades honestly feels like a world's difference. Even though it's a linear scaling from 60 to 120, it's just like you feel so much more comfortable with that distance. And you really do notice the difference.
Hasted Cow just barreling on through the jungle. SF kind of scares him away. They do have this rather large hard cam stack, which Brax is going to farm up now. So he'll get himself back up to max soul.
Well, Z-Freak's going to steal EXP here. This is good.
Yeah, gets a little bit. And that's definitely a good start. Ritsu also clearing through the easy cam stack with the help of his Dark Pact. Does Ritsu usually go for this build every time, the maxed out Dark Pack for greater farming capability?
Yeah. This is the standard starting build now. Ever since they nerfed the pounce damage, you should always max Dark Pack. It helps you farm the woods with the Tread Swap.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it really plays to the hero's strengths, right? So.
Yeah. But speaking here, it doesn't actually look like he's going for treads. It looks like, obviously, eventually, but he's going to go for the early Midas. Do you agree with this pickup? Do you think the early stats, especially given he's dealing with such early laning phase pressure, do you think that the stats would have been more valuable?
I think the Midas is completely fine. I think I always support the idea of playing Slark with a Midas.
Yeah.
It's kind of just like, can you get away with it kind of thing. And so far, Cole's applied a lot of lane pressure, and they got some good early kills. But they haven't been looking to do much else, honestly. Dizzy is farming the safe lane. He has a Drum of Endurance recipe instead of rushing bots or anything like that. So he's not going to be putting pressure for a long time, especially on the tower against the Dazzle. Earthshaker's been stacking. SF's just content pushing up the waves and farming stacks until his mech. And yeah, Clockwork's really just looking for a counter-initiate, and I think Cole respect that to an extent as well. So it looks like they're shaping up to a quiet game where they can macro up both sides and get their first set of items before they really rotate to do something.
Charge coming in, and he picks up the double damage, steals it away from Brax.
Oh, and MSS, he didn't bother going for that at all, did he?
No. He could have. Do you think they could have burst down?
Spearbreaker is so tanky. Honestly, it's tough. It's actually very tough. The thing with Spearbreaker against Clock is, while Clock shuts down Spearbreaker the way he does to like every other strength melee hero type of thing, Spearbreaker is an exceptionally tanky hero. And Cole already did have the Wyvern and Lina in position to start walking over. So I think it was kind of a wise slash safe call on MSS's part. But I do think they could burst him down low, like two level 4 raises.
Oh, he's trying to bank on the 17%, but he will be caught by MSS, who's waiting all this time inside of the jungle. They're actually going to go for Z-Freak here, continue to press forward. Lightstrike Array misses, but an Echo Slam finishes him off. Now MGW's going to get caught as well. Nice two-man pickup for Cloud9, turning things around and shutting down that aggro dual lane.
That was a really critical echo there. If they didn't get that echo kill, I'm not even sure if they could have followed up on the Mina kill, because the Pounce was then committed to finish off the Spirit Breaker. Really, really nice echo. I'm surprised he's got the levels that he has, but then again, he's been sitting on the safe lane soaking a lot of EXP. Got a lot of the stack EXP as well from Brax. And he was mid when Brax was dead, so yeah. Really good levels on SVG. This guy as a whole is impressing a lot of people, I believe.
Yeah, both him and Ritsu have been obviously two of the biggest North American standouts
new
right
blood.
Now.
Yep. Yeah. Youngins, as they call them.
Charge in.
Is he aware of this?
Z-Freak just scouting some vision of where MSS is rotating around. 1437 does get brought a bit low, as you said, from the Ember Spirit, but just a shallow grave and TP out.
You can't really stop that, of course. You have to chain in to even do that damage in the first place. There will be a time when MSS really actively pay attention to this.
SVG hoping to be able to deny himself to Roshan, gets into the pit, Dragon Slave comes out, he's brought low enough, and a Winter's Curse tried to stop him before he got to Roshan, but Roshan just takes that opportunity to almost finish him off. Winter Wyvern, though, gets the kill thanks to that Winter's Curse.
I wish I could rewind that.
Yeah, for a second there, I was just like, Roshan killed him, but it's because of the Winter's Curse, actually, then he gives the kill over to the Winter Wyvern.
Yeah.
So smart.
Was it that or Arctic Burn, though?
I don't know, but do you think Winter's Curse works that way? Where it even applying to Roshan?
I mean, it has to. I mean, when your teammates kill you, it doesn't deny you, right? So yeah, I guess it has to. I'm just surprised because I
guess
it was burned, but
yeah, I guess it's more of the factor. Does it apply to Roche? Can they be affected by Winter's Curse? And I can't see why not. I mean,
yeah, that was actually, looking back, that was a really nice Winter's Curse.
Yeah,
it has an animation too. So, and they're going into blind spot in the pit. I mean, it's kind of obvious what he was going to do for sure, but man, overall, way too. Having that awareness, using that ultimate. Again, these supports are just getting such high levels early, and it's making a huge impact on them.
Slark is about to be level 11. Top lane, 1437. He's just aggressively being here because he knows every single time that Ziz, if he's going to be able to get the kill, it's off the chains. Now he's going to be caught, though, because MJW is here as well. Shalgrave gets laid out, but Electric Array will stop him, so. Same trick is not going to work for us.
I'm pretty sure as soon as he saw the Lina, he doesn't do that anymore. Just save himself the TP. Yeah. He can port back into the lane after. I'm not even sure if he wants to because there's no tier 1 anymore, but yeah. Nice play by Cole.
Charge out to the bottom lane, but Ritsunu.
Brax farming up some stacks. He has a mech. Pretty farmed, I would say. Behind the TA and net worth, though, you know, in the past you would never see this where an SF gets behind on net worth against an enemy mid.
Radiant's bottom tower.
The ancient stacks.
Oh, Echo Slam! They're just gonna be able to burst down Z Freak. Nice pickup. SVG once again putting a stop to the Spirit Breaker. Excellent rotations. Winner will take the opportunity to snag that bounty room, but doesn't make up for the fact their lost comrade, Z Freak, down for another 20 seconds.
Yeah. Honestly, I think Cole looked at the map and said, okay, we have traps up and we have vision in XXX those places. Mm-hmm. And I think they felt too confident without an observer ward because observers just weren't giving the vision to the Earthshaker or anybody critically.
Oh, this is a little
Here's
awkward.
Case.
Winter's Curse, hookshot goes in, managed to grab MJW. SVG just barely managed to get off the fissure. Now the Shell Grave save, and he may be good. But on the left hand side, Ziz does finally reveal his invis rune to be able to get the pick off on the SF. Brax is down, 1437, not going to make it out. A chains catches him. Just in time. Well played by Ziz.
Yeah, Ziz actually made a really big play there. There's a lot of embers that don't realize you can cast spells in like in transition of his Dyer's fire remnant when he's doing his jump. I think he chained as he was like Radiant's jumping through the Slark, which is what gave him vision in the first place. That was just a good heads up play by Ziz and Cole as a whole. I thought they were walking in blind and they were kind of scared. But I think Swindle had the right idea. Whoever made the call saying, okay, I want Radiant's everybody else to rotate here and pressure fortified. Their woods. Because all five of them showed up very fast and they sniped the SF right away as well.
Yeah.
That, really nice job, Tekken.
That invis room meant everything, and Ziz now has drums plus boots of travel, so he can continue to really split push very aggressively while still potentially being there for those team fights. And without a blink dagger on Earthshaker, it's very unlikely that they ever kill this Ember Spirit now. When he's split pushing so aggressively and has a remnant out to be able to jump back to, the chances of them being able to chain stun him and take him from 100 to 0 is very unlikely.
Yeah, honestly, you said it perfectly, man. They have no catch for this Ember this game, and the SF went mech as a first item, so his ability to scale and transition, it's got set back pretty significantly. So I don't know, with an Ember having such a decent game like this, I mean, he's only got 6k net worth at 16 minutes, but this is like typically how Ember starts farming, because once they get their bots, they start split pushing like crazy, and their farm exponentially increases with the battle phase. Not to the same level as an Animage, but to a similar extent. Attack. Because of their Dyer's ability to just aggressively push and back and bots elsewhere. So, yeah, this is not looking good for C9 right now, with TA being at the top of the net worth and Roshan being in a potential always for the Dire side. They have to do something.
Yeah,
I'm not sure if their heroes can.
They have that maxed out meld ready to go. And if they wait much longer, it will be a Desolator. It's Winamons, and that means they just take it all the quicker. So, I honestly not sure. Unless Cloud9 just really timed their smoke perfectly, I don't see how they managed to catch Complexity
honestly,
during
I don't know. Stark's about to finish Shadowblade. He actually just finished it. But just given the amount of vision, they have no vision of their own woods, which is where Cole is dominating. And MSS has the awareness, and yeah, Roshan is definitely their next play. But can they even stop it? I just don't know.
Swindles is gonna clear through some more of these stacks. 4-7 right now.
Radiant's bottom tower
that board
is under attack.
Gonna be looking pretty scary soon. It's a 2,000 experience lead for Cole and 4,000 gold.
Yeah, this is like a very typical clock game though. Do you see how like MSS, he has such a good start, good lane and everything, but every time he has Rocket up, first of all, it's level 2. it doesn't hit creeps that hard. It doesn't hit heroes that hard at this point either.
Yeah.
And he's only scouting with it. He's just trying to keep vision on the Roche Pit because they have no other ways to scout it. And I'm going to throw that thought because Rex,
takes a bit of damage, but no real response from Complexity. They still have that Winter's Curse ready to go, but I think they just didn't really see an opportunity. Bottom. Is he really going to go into this? He's going to run kind of into Ritsu, so he'll just start trailing the Spirit Breaker on his way back. Sees that the charge is canceled, and the bait is a fail. So,
well, Did Ritsu stop giving vision? Because if he had vision on the SP, I think he could have just hooked the SP, and that would have been a well-needed kill there. Again, like, MSS's game here is just getting hindered so much. He's not farming anything, he's not getting any kill. He's 1-0-2, but you can just look at his net worth. He's below the net worth of the Spirit Breaker that was playing 4 position in the off.
Yeah.
It happens to Clockworks all the time, where they just get their blade mail by like 20 minutes, and at that point you might as well have just like 4 staff or something. Finally, the smoke is coming out. But again, with their heroes, can they really force a tower with this farm disadvantage? We'll have to find out in due time. Swindle has a Desolator now. He is so strong.
Yeah, he's been clearing through these stacks so quickly, even now trying to take the Radiant stack, but he will be kind of caught here. They will be able to instantly take away their Refraction. He's underneath the Counter Ward as well, so there's no reprieve whatsoever. That Counter Ward spotting him out. And that is a huge pickoff. 60 seconds till the Templar Assassin is back up. Not enough for Cloud9 to take any real big objective, but they have just kind of stalled up what was the inevitable Roshan. Complexity.
Yeah, that was a really well needed pickoff actually. They can, I was about to say they can force top tower out of this. They can't force mid because Wyvern's already in position and it's really easy to rotate heroes mid in general. Top is kind of isolated, but it does have the Ember Remnant presence there, so it's kind of hard to. But yeah, you see how Cap, like, they took a huge kill on the most farmed hero on the map, and they're not really making anything out of it.
Yeah.
It goes to show you their position, how locked they are in. Bound they are by their own picks as well as their position.
Yeah, the best they could really do was like have the Slark run out into the enemy jungle and try and find an additional pickoff and just kind of like go pickoff into pickoff, and maybe then with enough pickoffs they would find an opening. But he didn't get anything. The Lina was able to back up in time and finish up the Yule Scepter. And now we're right back to where we were just a couple minutes more. Sure, Cloud9 got a small little network jump, but it's still the same predicament, which is Complexity will take Roshan. They have this really powerful Templar Assassin with Blink and Desolator. And an Ember Spirit that is about to finish up Battle Fury in a short period of time. This is just going to be mid-game domination for Complexity with this Aegis into a pretty good mid-to-late game position with the TA in him.
Yeah, this is a... Cloud9 play this style very often, where they just want to drag out the game and have Ritsu farm and maybe Brax keeping up depending on his hero, and just play for the high ground type of thing. But honestly, I doubt their potential late game, honestly. Just this TA will like 1-2-shot so many heroes that they're pressuring the bottom tower now, and finally I think Cloud9 get their first tower this game. But they'll have to follow up because if Complexity does this right, they can either force base with the Aegis, force TP, or they can just go mid and get even more.
Mid lane, they're going to go for 1-4-3-7. The chains will stop them, so they do get that pickoff right after the Tier 2 tower. So a Tier 2 for a Tier 1, plus a hero on the side. A great trade for Complexity. And they, yeah, as you said, you're going to go Tier 2 middle. What are the items that Cloud9 need? I mean, we now have the BKB for Brax, so that's a start. Do you need something additional on Ritsu before you can really fight Complexity?
They need multiple items on their carries. This is the big concern for them right now. And I'm gonna have to hold that thought. Oh, the Brax TP, so the SD wasn't able to charge and scale on the clockwork and the
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Yeah, in their game position right now, what they need is both an item advantage on the TA, on the Slark, as well as the Shadow Fiend. And at this rate they're just not gonna get it, man. They're getting pressure too hard on their lanes, and I'm not sure if Cole will get a gem. But if they get a gem and start dewarding the map too, they're going to feel super pressed. Like, the only hero that can walk out is, like, Ritsu, probably.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he even mentioned gem. Gem's going to be a problem for Cloud9 for them to play their game.
Yeah. Just continue to lock down the vision. And I've been kind of looking at it for Complexity. the very aggressive, like the traps are all over the place that Swindle has set up, and they actually offer so much vision.
Yeah, it's actually ridiculous. TA is such a good hero this patch. It's just like Ancients and Roshan just make this hero like super.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Wait, how do they see? How do they see the sentry? Yeah, they picked up. Yeah, they have gem on way too actually. This is yeah. Crunch time for Cloud9 here. It's hard to burning, going to high ground, scouting out for wards. They will find the one in their wards. It's a very common place. It's 3/4 of the time passed, so it'll expire relatively soon. But they will find it, they will deny it. And Cloud9 will feel the ever-growing darkness of the map.
Yeah, they certainly will. They've only got that one river ward, and that's actually going to go away in 35 seconds, so no need to wait out complexity finding it. It's just looking worse and worse all across the map. Meanwhile, you take a look at the dire side vision. They just have like kind of aggressive vision plus traps everywhere. And then you have Spirit Breaker, who's always kind of like scouting out these heroes with he doesn't even complete attack. The charge. Like 90% of the times, he's just been like charging, getting as much vision as possible until he needs to cancel the charge. And then that's it. Just gains a whole lot of information, essentially. Looking to try and lock down.
Sure, I think I was casting the other day, watching some of the monkey business team.
Yeah.
So I initially doubted how Lumiander plays this 2-1-4 clockwork, where he actually maxes Rocket Foot every game.
Yeah.
But I'm starting to wonder if that's actually the right way to play the problem. I'm gonna have to go, man.
All that physical damage from Swindlemelons just pops them. And I kind of agree with you. I mean, just the way your item progression slows
look
down.
At this clock. He's so sad right now. Like 23 minutes in, after having such a good lead, he's level 9. He doesn't have max Rocket Flare, which is kind of okay. But you really want it so you can push lanes faster, get more vision with the 14-second cooldown. But really, it's just, you're just so sad. The way I see Lumiander play the clockwork nowadays, like he always dies in the offhand. He plays so hyper-aggressive, just dies multiple times to the point where it looks like a feed.
Yeah.
But he always gets it back because he forced these, like, he engraved this idea to this enemy where he's like, okay, this guy's just gonna die if he runs into us again. And he forces these fights that once he just gets one fight that's good for him, he gets like 3 levels and catches back completely. Mm-hmm. And then he has this max rocket that he can spam to push out waves and get intel hero snipes and stuff like that. I don't know, it might be the correct way of playing clockwork, and MSS has not been playing this bad at all. But I feel like the presence of what a clockwork got compared to what a clockwork did in this game, compared to what he had in the early game, it definitely seems underwhelming. But he's been playing this pretty well, of course.
Dazzle's trying to work towards Medallion. SVG just needs the... Oh no, give it to him, Ritsu! He'll get it through Tickle. Blink Dagger is coming in. Maybe that's the turnaround, but it's still going to be rough with Way 2. If he can finish up a mobility item of his own, they still have that counter initiation whenever the Earthshaker jumps in. And you know, because they have a melee carry, the Earthshaker is going to jump in. You just throw down that Winter's Curse, you're very likely to catch the Clockwork and probably the Slark as well. So. He knows it's coming. We'll be able to catch up. 1437 turns around, pops Shalgrave. Now MSS actually gets a really good hook shot and locks down two with the Blade Mail. They don't want to fight him, so they'll just give up on that one. Brax actually pops his ultimate, and this delays a lot of the damage to Swindle, and turn around and go for 1437. Does get that one kill. And Way 2, well, it gets off the ultimate onto Brax. It doesn't look like they're going to be able to stop this one. He just gets 3 shots so quickly. 2 from Swindle. Ritsu comes in from the side, goes for Way 2, Cold Embrace, saving things. Oh. Echo Slam gets laid out from SJV, and now that's the opening that they desperately needed. Echo Slam actually. MJW will go down the Fissure. Not quite enough. MSS now trying to Battery Assault. Take away. Rocket turnaround. Couldn't quite get it. Z-Freak lives just a little bit longer, and SVG will go down to the right clicks. Swindlemelons. Ritsu comes in. Will be able to one-shot that Spirit Breaker and back out safely. That Echo Slam. I mean, that was starting to look like Complexity were just going to be able to push uphill right after the kill on Brax, but that Echo Slam turned things around dramatically enough that Cloud9 will keep their Tier 3 tower from any pressure.
Yeah, I guess you can never really count out an Earthshaker with a Blink Dagger. The way he turns fights this patch is crazy, but SVG, I can't give enough credit to this guy. He honestly does this every game, whatever hero he's on. Like, his positioning and patience is really something to be commended every time. But I think Swindle, I thought he was in danger, but the Shadow Blade was just inspiring, so I can understand why Ritsu decided to back off.
Yeah.
But honestly, despite the nice comeback towards the end there from Cloud9, they still lost that fight. And we can already see it in the network too. PA still ahead, Ember still sort of ahead. And it's not like the teamfight will get better for Cloud9. Drax has a mech and a BKB. He's not going to be a presence in these fights anymore. He can get an ulti off, and that might be good, but TA got BKB first time after the Deso Blink. So he's going to nullify all the damage coming out of the SF to an extent, Slark.
2K still in the SF.
Oh, the Thought of Mystery. Maybe Dizzy.
Oh! Push back. The charge is still going to catch him, though. MSS, unless he, like, hookshots away, Z-Freak's going to finish him off with the ultimate. So that's a free kill there. 1437. Also, maybe going to go down a little bit more. Shallow Grave goes off just in time. And they're still going to chase him down. Brax actually threatening the ultimate there, but Ziz can just jump back to his remnant at any point in time. So they hold on to it. That'll be the Dazzle and the Clockwork down. Clockwork does have a buyback and has the hookshot ready to go. So if Complexity push in a bit too deep, they may try and challenge them. That'll require Ritsu to come back. This TP scroll. Simple Fisher Block and Complexity are not going to try and push uphill. They're very content with where the game is at this point. They're not going to try and rush things too much. The charge in, they've actually caught Ritsu. And Ritsu should know because of his ultimate, but he also probably realizes he's far enough ahead that Z-Freak won't really be able to threaten
Radiant's
him too much.
Bottom tower is under attack.
Z-Freak is in trouble. He doesn't have a TP. Oh, Ritsu's just making up because he's scared. He doesn't see anybody else on the map. Little does he know that the entire team is far away and he could have actually sniped him or something. Close to it anyway. Swindle was coming, so it's kind of a risky move regardless.
Do you go for Bash next on Ritsu? Just additional lockdown that you desperately need?
Well, he has the Poor Man Scotty, which is the SMY. I guess he could. I think he definitely needs one at some point in this game as well, because he's pretty much a solo carry at this point. While his team is creating, like, chaos and havoc in the fights, he has to do, like, the bulk load of the damage, the one to kill the Ember and the TA. And again, they do lack catch for the Ember, so Bash is probably a really good item here. Not sure if that's what he's actually called for. He is relatively squishy. If he does get caught, he'll be brought down for sure by the Templar, Lina, and all these other sources of damage. The Cloud9 is going for a 5-man smoke. This, again, like with 5-man smokes, it's just too obvious.
Yeah.
I don't think Complexity, like anybody on Complexity, will get caught by this one.
Yeah, top.
You know what? Now that I look at it, it's a Roshan smoke, so they kind of have to do it.
Yeah, it's top and bottom lane, both pushing in. I'm sure Complexity are aware of what's happening. In fact, they see, Ritsu is going to be immediately double ulted here, but it's not going to be enough by itself. Echo Slam gets laid down, two already dead, and the Clockwork just barely managed to survive. In fact, he healed up pretty well. Ritsu got off the ultimate, will be able to turn things around. He'll come back later. MSS, he's definitely dead. Ziz and Swindlemon's just output too much damage. Now someone needs to say Brax, SVG. He's got his Fissure, lines it up. Yeah, can't quite get it just yet. Stunned up a little bit by Ziz. Now he's in some serious trouble. Needs to be able to buy himself some time for a blink out, but that's not going to happen. He's going to die to MJW next. And Ritsu never really found that opening to head on in. He just gets the kill on the Spirit Breaker, and that was pretty much it. Once they got that two-man initiation, where he got double ulted, they got those two kills. It was starting to look like, okay, maybe they can actually turn as a group and fight against Ziz and Swindlemones, but their damage was just too great. They just cut through the members of Cloud9 too quickly for them to be able to group up.
Yeah, honestly, Cap, that fight was a perfect example of the weaknesses of the draft coming in for Cloud9 against Cold9 specifically. Cole have just way more sort of damage. Every hero on Cole can do some sort of damage one way or another.
Yeah.
On Cloud9, they have Dazzle and Earthshaker and Clockwork. Clockwork, after he cogs like that, he doesn't have any more damage. Earthshaker after a Fissure, unless he's getting a huge echo, which he kind of did, but they were like two dead targets already because they were in the cog. So after that, he doesn't really have a follow-up on other heroes either. Mm-hmm. So again, like this is a solo carry Slark thing with the Shadow Fiend. I thought Shadow Fiend just finished the Scotty. I was like, holy crap, where the hell did that come from?
No.
Yeah.
All
even
right,
if
so.
He had a Scotty, it would have been hard. And yeah. Of course, look at his farm right now. He's nothing close. He's got 2 pieces. No, one. He's got 1 piece. But yeah, that's basically nothing close to it.
Yeah. So he just picks up one of the ultimate orbs, but we have a full Scotty, as you saw from Ender Spirit now. So a lot of stats for him. Oh, yeah. Is it MKB or is it Daedalus? If you're this far ahead and you know, especially the SF showing the ultimate orb, do you go Daedalus now? No,
he actually
you're right.
Has the MKB.
Yeah.
Yeah. Honestly, it's fine. MKB is a really good item regardless. Yeah. I know Daedalus generally gives you more damage, but this game he's one-shotting, two-shotting supports anyway. Like, it doesn't change the game.
So
why not just shut down that potential Solar Crest slash Butterfly coming out of one of their cores or supports with the Solar Crest, right?
Right.
It's just, this is a good item. And I think they're going to look to push high ground off this with the Aegis.
Yeah, you could also probably say that he finished up the MKB right before the Ultimate Orb could have been seen. So maybe you just assume the ESF was going for the Butterfly next.
So yeah, Scotty's not on the Ember. He's really strong, and this is kind of a lot of Embers have begun to start picking it up more frequently, the Scotty. It's very good. We used to do this on Cloud9, because the build-up with the item is kind of awkward for a hero like Ember, who doesn't really burst farm. So, again, they're going to just high ground off this Aegis, and I think they can do it. They're super strong right now.
Push forwards, middle bounds. Starting to chip away at that tier 3 tower. Asher now for the Slark, but it's not an item that you feel like it's going to change a whole lot unless he gets real lucky.
I think Swindle, when he chained the 1437, I think Swindle could literally just blink him one shot. I don't know. That's it's a pretty easy kill on the Dazzling if they get it. Which they could have, I think, then the fight becomes that much easier.
Mm-hmm. They've waited out the weave, and they'll probably push aggressively. That weave was probably the most dangerous factor. Now Swindle could just sit on the front lines and easily take down the 2-3 tower.
They can take a slow siege like this, too. Yeah, and the Aegis is probably around for like another 2-3 minutes, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 2 minutes, right? So there goes the, there goes the tower.
Ritsu's saying, I can't hold, I'm just gonna get a better position, try to go for back. He's bounced down, Shadow Bladed, and this might be their goal. Got spotted out though, so he has to be careful now.
Yeah, Warden Counter Ward situation. Now, Complexity are like, okay, we know exactly, we have the whole entire area surrounded in Counter Ward, so we're just gonna finish up this melee rack. MSS goes in, actually bumps back Swindlemons, but they charge into the side, going for Ritsu, who managed to pounce himself away, but still gets caught by Ultimate 1 and Ultimate 2, Ultimate 3 to finish him off. Laguna Blade will finish him, and he's gonna have to be forced into a buyback here, especially with Brax dropping lower all the time. But I think Ritsu at the same time doesn't see an endgame scenario if he buys back. Now the 1-4-3-7, oh, Shallowgrave forced out. Now he buys back. Ritsu hoping to be able to find that opening, but Complexity very clean.
Stay, honestly. Yeah, I'm pretty sure they're just gonna stay.
Yeah. Dual Scepter combination, MSS gets off the Blade Mail, but he will end up going down. Ritsu managed to finish off the Lina at the very least. Now turns to go on to Swindlemons, who popped his BKB, and Ritsu knows he has to back himself up. Pounce over, slow down. Ziz is actually going to be able to get the chains onto Ritsu. Has Dark Pack in a second, but he's just going to take too much damage. And with him down now for 90 seconds, that's got to be the GG.
Yeah, it's game. Second round going down with 1-3-7, graving himself nicely there, but not really enough to hold the base. Swindle didn't even lose the Aegis, and he'll probably just full heal from the Aegis effect. There is GG. Again, they just got outpicked and outstratted, honestly. If the SF loses the lane this game, which he sort of did because he got behind on farm, even though he played the lane well, they have no follow-up because Slark can't pressure powers, and with Dazzle Earthshaker, they're not going to rotate to get kills from the clockwork either. And just how Complexity controlled the offlane, took the initial tower, and then just kept map pressure from there on, it was done well enough to take over. And Ziz, as you can see, 9-0-6, applied the correct amount of pressure, got the solo kills he needed, and they took the game in a standard and a methodical approach.
Well played by Complexity. See if they can take it in a 2-0 here. We're going to have a short break. Skype is back too, so we'll probably jump over there, and we'll be back with game number 2.